The Eclipse of God. Is religion on the way out? What is happening to God? Martin Buber gave us a helpful image, the eclipse of God. God's light is always there, but sometimes during a solar eclipse it gets temporarily obscured by the moon, so nothing else on earth can reflect God's light. That's what we see happening in modern society. Here are some of the perpetrators: cosmologists, biochemists, biologists, geneticists, neuroscientists. They are all scientists who use their scientific authority to promote opinions and views that go far beyond their scientific expertise in order to obscure God. So they create relativist, secularist, and atheist. That's what this new book is about. You can find it at genesispc.com/books. And it discusses what cosmologists have done to God, biochemists, biologists, geneticists, neuroscientists, relativists, secularists, and atheists. The first chapter goes into cosmology very extensively. Stephen Hawking, for instance, speaks of a spontaneous creation because there is a law such as gravity. The universe can and will create itself from nothing. Spontaneous creation is the reason there is something rather than nothing. That is the end of God the Creator. Really? Things cannot just pop themselves into existence. They must have a cause, because they cannot have the power to make themselves exist, for then they would have to exist before they came into existence. It's impossible for things to pop into being without a cause, out of nothing. Only God can create out of nothing. Biochemists say, for instance, Francis Crick, the co-discoverer of DNA, almost all aspects of life are engineered at the molecular level, and without understanding molecules we can only have a very sketchy understanding of life itself. Carl Sagan says the material world is all that is or ever was or ever will be. It has replaced God. But God keeps standing. It is not only molecules that shape our behavior, but everything that we see and hear around us, plus all the dreams, hopes, ideals, plans, and expectations we foster in our minds. God keeps standing. Biologists say, Francis Crick again, chance is the only source of true novelty. If that is true, we end up living in a world of blind fate. Chance is considered blind. It has no favorites, no memory, and no foresight. But God keeps shining his light. Chance can never create the order found in this world, just as blindness can never create sight. Scientists have no right as scientists to decree that we are unintended, unplanned, unguided, fortuitous creatures, or mere products of a blind and purposeless fate. That is beyond their competence as scientists. Geneticist and God. One of them, Sidney Brenner, once said he could compute an entire organism if he were given its DNA sequence and a large enough computer. Imagine. That obscures God again. But these people want us to believe that everything is predetermined. But how could they make us believe so, for wouldn't that belief be as predestined as anything else? Genes would also determine our choice to believe or not to believe that genes determine everything. And then there are neuroscientists. Francis Crick again. The astonishing hypothesis is that you, your joys and your sorrows, your memories and your ambitions are in fact no more than the behavior of a vast assembly of nerve cells. In other words, he wants to replace mind talk with brain talk. No more mind talk. But God keeps shining his light. If we think a mental state would simply be a certain pattern of electrical activity in our brain cells, then we should realize this. The very idea that concepts and thoughts are nothing but neurons firing is itself nothing but neurons firing. That is self-destructive. Relativists and God. They say, whatever is true for me may be false for you. Whatever is right for me may be wrong for someone else. All there is are nothing but opinions about what is true or false, about what is right or wrong. No more truth. The problem with a claim like there is no such a thing as objective truth is that it claims to be objectively true. Truth is truth, absolutely, even if you do not accept it. And untruth is untruth, even if you claim it. And then secularists say, for instance, Justice, Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy, the right to define one's own concept of existence, of meaning, of the universe, and of the mystery of human life. That is the right everyone has. This is secularism that leaves no room for anything but itself. It allows only its own views and values in public life. On the other hand, William Penn, the founder of Pennsylvania, warned us, men must be governed by God, or they will be ruled by tyrants. John F. Kennedy put it well in his inaugural address, the rights of man come not from generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. A profound truth. But still, there are many atheists. Richard Lewontin says we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. In other words, atheists choose not to accept God because they dislike the way the world looks to them with God in the picture. Archbishop Fulton Sheen said years ago atheism was an individual phenomenon. Today, atheism is social. A famous atheist was Jean-Paul Sartre, French philosopher. He confessed just before his death, I do not feel that I am the product of chance, a speck of dust in the universe, but someone who was expected, prepared, prefigured, in short, a being that only a creator could put here. And this idea of a creating hand refers to God. Imagine a former atheist. No matter what, God is still there. As Saint Augustine said, to fall in love with God is the greatest of romances, to seek Him the greatest adventure, to find Him the greatest human achievement. The eclipse of God. That's what this book is about, and it explains everything extensively and defends everything extensively.